Alles ist Architektur. This quote that you all know is from 1968, publication by Hans Olein in Bow magazine, in which he proclaims that everything which constitutes the physical world can be considered as architecture. Architecture must be freed from buildings, he says. In this 30 pages manifesto comprising a selection of images at different scale, reminiscent of landscape or building, and a short paragraph of text, Holein invites readers to extend their understanding of architecture. Everything is architecture. In turn, we proclaim that everything is fiction. One of the preconceptions that we have inherited from the modern movement is that fiction draws us away from the more noble question for truth. This idea of hegemonic truth has been contradicted in many fields, including sciences, yet the concept of truth is upheld by the idea of rationality, which is a reassuring illusion to architects. We believe that the role of the architect, beyond creating spaces to serve society, is to represent, criticize, and ultimately offer alternative fiction to the ones which form the basis of our societies. Everything is fiction. Let's begin with some etymology. The word fiction derives from the Latin verb fictio, which means handle, touch, caress, compose, curl, shape, feign, pretend, invent, picture, and imagine. Fiction is present at every step of a project making. Every thought emerges from a particular individual's mind, bearing the fiction of their reality and society. The users, in turn, will appropriate the space and the layer it with their own fictions. Fictions have effect. You can create a border between people before building the wall. In 1911, German philosopher Hans Wegener published Die Philosophie des Halbobst, in which he shows that fiction is an operative tool used by all fields of investigation, and in particular mathematics and most scientific reason. Wegener, as if philosophy, states that human beings, not knowing the underlying truths of the world, we construct systems of thought and then assume that these match reality. He even states that we can only perceive those phenomena on which we have mastered the fiction. We behave as if the world matches our models. Strong admirer of mathematics, Wegener uses mostly references to mathematics and physics, but he also referred to this syllogism: all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore Socrates is mortal. We attribute to this unique case Socrates, a fictional filter of analysis, man. This category is a construct. There exists no general man, seeing as all men are individuals. This syllogism leads to a truth, which is that Socrates is mortal. According to Wegener, fiction bear a positive role because they contribute to identifying the truth. Fictions are operative tools. Everything is fiction. This building is one of the emblems of architectural history, the Athenian Parthenon. It is considered to be one of the founding buildings of our architectural culture, although research led that the Sumerian people contradict this. Here you see the very essence of the white purity of European architecture, despite the fact that it was probably painted very vividly. This building is a temple dedicated to the goddess Athena. So most of us probably agree that Athena is one of the constitutive fiction of ancient Greece. At that time, the Olympus gods were considered general truth and largely uncontested. When we use the word fiction, we are tempted to associate it with terms such as dishonesty, lie, or deception, which in turn question the authenticity of a work. In that sense, it is interesting to remind ourselves that Greek temples were the stone abstraction of historical wooden temples. This is the Cordoba de Mesquita. that you probably all know. It was first a Visigoth church, which was then divided in two halves to be shared with Muslims. It was then purchased by an emir to become solely a mosque, until a cathedral was constructed inside, and it became solely Catholic. This building has been vested with numerous truths which cohabitate and accommodate to the space. Another building testifying to such an imbrication of beliefs is the Roman Pantheon. This antique building was first a pagan temple, then a Catholic church, and now a temple to mass tourism. Every architecture is constructed through fiction and its contradiction. The Pantheon is one of those buildings which is suited to accommodating various stories and contributing to write new ones. Bruno Latour is one of the thinkers of sociology of scientific knowledge, which deals with the social condition and effect of science, and with the social structure and processes of scientific activity. To put things differently, we could say that it aims at reasserting the myth behind scientific processes. In his 1991 book, We Have Never Been Modern, Latour questioned the differences between pre-modern people and modernity, which assumes nature and culture as two opposing and contradictory forces. According to Latour, this rationality of science not only doesn't exist, but rather fiction and experiment are the founding element of science. The first of our modern fiction is that our progress, which supposedly is towards a better future, now Latour is inviting us to create fiction able to offer an alternative to our ecological crisis. Thanks to Latour and other cultural studies, we now know that there is no universal truth. Each culture develops its own story, its own myth, and we should strive to identify any question. Humans are cultural animals, and architecture is a cultural product. The Palace of Justice of Brussels was built during almost 20 years, for 1866 to 1883, by Joseph Poulard. It was the largest building built in the 19th century. Built on the top of the valley, it is a landmark that you can see from all over the city. Justice never sleeps. The project is born from the wish of the first king of Belgium. This project belonged to a long tradition of nascent nations inventing their history, inverting their fiction. In order to write this fiction, Poulard draws inspiration from classical architecture, almost as if a few columns were enough to bring to life an eternal people. Slovenian philosopher Slavoj Žižek, in his perverted Guide to Ideology, uses Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, Ode to Joy, to illustrate works which have supported very different, even contradictory fictions. Ode to Joy was played at Hitler's birthday, as well as during communist rally. Today it is the official hymn of the EU and was lately used at Emmanuel Macron's investiture. According to Žižek, this piece bears this because it withholds a deep contradiction of its own embodied by a Turkish march, which appears unexpectedly at the end of the piece. For us, classical architecture has the same power as Beethoven's Turkish march. It embodies the hope and dream of authoritarian regime from both extremes as well as democratic ideals. Architecture is colored by this value. It is an evolving fiction. The Danteum is a fascinating building. It is a monument dedicated to the Italian poet Dante, designed by Giuseppe Terani for the Rome World Fair in 1942. Its ambition was to promote the grandeur of Mussolini's new fascist nation. The Italian radicals were the architects of Mussolini's service, and they too refer to classical architecture as well as fiction and myth to construct the Italy Mussolini dreamed. Terani's project relates Dante's Divine Comedy. The visitor follows the route from hell to heaven through the geometric composition of the space. Terani transposes the poem into sequences, rhythm, and proportion. It is not an illustration of the poem, it is the poem. As opposed to pull art architecture entangled with grandiose, Italian rationalist architecture is more specifically destined to hosting crowd and not the abstraction of a crowd. The Casa del Fascio, constructed in 1936 by Terrani, was the headquarters of the Fascist Party in the small city of Como in northern Italy. It draws its reference for Palazzo Farnese, a Roman palace, from the Renaissance, which is remarkable for its use of tree order vertically along the facade as a progression from heavy to light. Casa del Fascio refers both this historical building to narrate a common history for Italy and offers an interpretation through architecture of a transparent regime open to its people. The facade, like the plan, with their system of emptiness, testify to this openness. In the background is the powerful fascist fiction, a new man freed from his chain in a unified new Italian nation. Leaving the realm of epicness and back to a fiction which is closer to home to us, but should also sound familiar to you, the fiction of the Belgian nation. This is not the story of the creation of this small country, which is nearly 200 years old. Is still structured around the monarch, but of the question of the reconstruction of its city after the World War I. The book, Resurgam, published in 1985, sheds light upon the moment of reconstruction during which Belgium invented a new myth for itself, that of the bourgeois mansion. Although it was an uncharacteristic housing typology, it was used as a founding block for new urban development, the result of which is the Flemish-style pitched roof house. The reconstruction of a nation is a difficult task, in that it requires the creation of a new and artificial identity based on historical myth. Roma Interrotta. This project proposed the creation of a new Roma. It is a characteristic project of the movement known as ARO, which is an architectural movement from the 1980s. Its members rose to oppose the so-called destruction of the historical fabric of the city. They proposed a project as a manifesto for continuing the construction of European cities based on the typology of bourgeois housing and classical architecture with the aim of making cities more human. Their urban model refers to undefined dreams for a traditional, authentic, anti-modern, and peaceful city. One of their leading thinkers, Léon Clear, indeed contributed to this dream by building a few residential suburbs in the US. On the surface, they oppose the international and transversal ideals of the modern movement by referring to the fiction of small medieval bourgeois towns, though the modern fiction were not challenged, merely camouflaged behind cute brick facade. Along the line of urban fictions, the Garden City, which was implemented in Belgium following Ebenezer Howard theories, opposes the model of the industrial city, mother of all vices. The Garden City offers a retreat in the countryside for working class family. Not in the form of an autarchic retreat, but rather as a community organized around a civic center. Consequently, the Garden City model was very soon stifled in Belgium on the basis of the fear of the emergence of communist worker community, otherwise named Red Suburbs. These fictions are not only expressed through architectural objects, but are also embodied in landscape, city, and territorial planning. Atlantropa was presented for the first time by German architect Hermann Zörgel in the 1920s. This unrealized plan projected the construction of several massive dams across the Mediterranean Sea, resulting in the significant lowering of sea levels, thus creating new arable land for agriculture and allowing increased connection between Europe and Africa. The project planned on installing various large-scale infrastructure connecting the two continents, hence facilitating trade. This project is a fiction, the fiction of two united continents. It is fascinating in the fact that it depicts an alternative future. It opens new land of investigation and contest what we take for granted in international relations. Across the Atlantic, Jefferson developed his grid system in 1796. Architect and President of the United States, Thomas Jefferson imagined a territorial management tool which reflected this new nation's democratic ideals. Jefferson's grid supplied all over the US landscape and inscribed upon it the principle of equality. Because the grid, according to Jefferson, makes each point equal to all other. This grid system is tangible in many American cities and still supports the discourse of the American dream, equality of chances. However, the grid system can also convey the complementary values of total control and alienation through extreme rationalization. The exact same territorial typology expresses in China radically different values. The grid creates a hierarchy upon the emperor's territory by emanating from its center, the Imperial Palace of Beijing. Each point is measured in relation to its distance from the center. The grid, like any model, is a fiction as such as we can oppose it to it. Alles ist fiction, everything is fiction. There is no universal truth. Architecture is a cultural act, and as such, as convey its own fictions. Fiction is an operative device which allows us to question contemporaneity, and it is a constructive device allowing it to impact our culture. It allows to be aware of the cultural framework in which action and ideas take place. Fiction are everywhere, and we need more fiction in which we want to believe. Fictions able to express our democratic agenda, but also fiction are able to save the world from all the worlds that were built by other ones. Everything is fiction. Today, I would like to share with you two fictions. The first one is Ode to Joy, which is our first project as Strong Novel, and the second one is Eurotopie, which is our first build one. For the first one, we would like to show only one image. Eurotopie. We have discovered a new land that is neither near nor far, at times youthful, yes, at times decrepit. It has existed for several millennia and will most likely outlive us. It is sometimes called a continent, sometimes a peninsula. It seems to stretch from the Ural Mountain to the Atlantic Ocean. Yet its boundaries are ill-defined, occasionally doubted. It has also inspired remarkable faith. We have called this land Eurotopie. Built upon the ashes of totalitarianism, Eurotopie ridicules methodological nationalism and the derelict nation-state. Eurotopie deconstructs the idea that nations create societies. Eurotopie is a call for liberation from the underlying myth of peoples, nations, and power. Eurotopie is a mirror of our time, taking what it receives and reflecting it out towards a new destination. Eurotopie strives to repoliticize our world, considering neoliberalism to be a lever rather than an invariable given. Eurotopie sizes its existing tools to define a new field of struggle. Eurotopie is a common dream, the last utopia, the hope for shared ambition. Eurotopie is a meta-nation, beyond the nations. It embodies an emancipatory project, the only narrative that is able to counter nationalism. Its most singular manifestation, despite its incompleteness, is in Brussels, in the regally named Leopold Quarter, which is sometimes also referred to as the European Quarter. In Brussels, we thought we would find one world capital within another, sometimes akin to the Vatican inside Rome. We expected an overload of symbols, expression of power, order, and domination. Some say the European Quarter appeared out of nowhere, that there were no founding. Some say it lacks ambition, that its buildings have no architect, that its streets have no planners. What we found was an infraordinary manifestation of supranational power, cemented into an archaic architectural form reminiscent of obsolete power. Eurotopy is asymbolic and non-hegemonic. What we uncovered was an invitation to a restrained one to think reality in a different way, and by doing so, to imagine new tools to change the present. What is Eurotopy, you ask, and how may one reach it? Here is a sanctuary where citizens are building the new Europe. It is vast enough to gather crowd, secluded enough to embrace the lonely step of those who seek answer. It can be explored from top to bottom, left to right, and diagonally. Revolving bodies searching. The light is opalescent. Its intensity varies following the values of the seasons. The floor is ultramarine blue. It reflects onto the walls and colors the space. It is consensual. It is a relic. The masonry walls are painting white. Eyes tend to lose their focus. It is either very hot or very cold. The pavilion reacts to the climate. The space is cross-shaped. At its center is a 5.3-meter diameter circle at which 25 people are seated. Scale is different here. Some doors are 1.4-meter high. Bodies must fold themselves in order to reach the alcoves. Vestiges of other uses can be perceived. The pavilion is made up of 7 spaces, all the same, all different. Their width varies from 3.2 meters to 10 meters. Their length varies from 5.8 meters to 17 meters. Their height varies according to the ground and movement. At the center, the radiant ceiling is 6 meters high. In the lateral niches, where those who prefer to ponder alone the state of the Union seek refuge, it can be reached with finger. The ground rises, dips, and rises again. Movement recomposes a dodecaphonic ode throughout the space. There are steps at 30 centimeters high. They are both obstacle and resting places for tired bodies. A travel diary brought back from Eurotopy can be lived through. Citizens listen to other citizens speaking of Europe's legacy and another Europe yet to be. This space is a pavilion. This space is a sanctuary. This space is a place. People crying or people laughing may be encountered here. Others shouting, others lecturing. This space is one of those in which secrets can be whispered. Citizens are free. Here is Eurotopy under construction. This is your pavilion. This is your Europe. Welcome to Eurotopy. Thank you.